The city of Waukegan is replacing about 20,000 water meters with a new automated meter, which provide for an accurate, timely, and reliable reading without having to gain access to customers' properties. The new meters, which will be replaced at no cost to the customers, will be able to identify high water usage and potential leaks. In addition, customers will be able to access their water usage and account information conveniently online. The first thing you need to do is schedule an appointment with Professional Meters, Inc. to have your old meter replaced with a new automated meter reader, AMR for short. Look for a postcard in the mail with the call information or call 866-270-9629. PMI will arrive at your scheduled time to install your meter. They will arrive on a truck or a van with a PMI logo. The PMI installer will have on a shirt or a jacket with a PMI logo and will carry a PMI ID badge. Installers will also wear booties over their work boots to ensure they do not carry dirt, mud, or water into your home or business. The installation process should take less than 30 minutes. The installer will take a photo of the old meter to obtain a record of your final meter reading and the condition of the pipes and fittings. The next step is to turn off your shut-off valves located on your water meter line near the meter. Remove the old meter and install the new AMR meter. The transmitter, which transmits your water usage data to the city, will be placed on a convenient location near the meter. The installer will take a photo of the new meter once it's installed. And that's it. The PMI installer will make sure everything is cleaned up, collect his tools, and head on to the next installation. You may receive a follow-up visit from a PMI manager to ensure your satisfaction with the installation and to make a quality control check of the meter installation. For more information about the automated meter reading installation program, please visit www.waukeganil.gov. If you have any questions regarding the meter installation, contact PMI at 866-270-9629 or the City of Waukegan City Collector at 847-599-2997.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the January 17th, 2017 Waukegan City Council meeting. Roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Alderman Newsom.
Present.
Alderman Tempest.
Present.
Alderman May.
Present.
Alderman Valco.
Present.
Alderman Taylor.
Present.
Alderman Cunningham.
Present.
Alderman Seeger.
He's here.
He's here.
He's coming
in.
Moisio.
Here.
Alderman Villalobos.
Present.
Please stand for the pledge and the invocation.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you again for another City Council meeting. We thank you for all your blessings. Today we remember Dr. King taught us that we should love each other. Love is better than hate. We thank you for his legacy. We thank you for all our leaders. We thank you for the mayor, for this council from the first to the ninth ward. Pray that you bless each one of them. Bless the police department, the fire department, all the department heads, that we all work together in unity. Where there's unity, there's strength. I pray these blessings in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
No mayor's comments, minutes. Motion to approve the regular minutes of January 3rd, 2017. Motion by Alderman May, second by Alderman Mozo. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Resolutions, proclamations, presentation, appointments. Art, Joaquin Main Street.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members, audience. I'm a firm believer when somebody says something eloquently, the way I would like to say it, why make revisions? I recently read this, and I'd like to share the perspectives of the writer. Downtown revitalization is one of the most complex, challenging undertakings anyone can embark on. There are many skeptics, and even those who support the process may have unrealistic expectations and frustrations. Yet seeing a dead downtown come to life is a great reward for any community and worth investing time, energy, and emotion. We are about to embark on a membership drive. We hope that the residents of Waukegan will see value in becoming members of Waukegan Main Street. By doing so, you have the opportunity to influence as well as be a part of the solution. If you have any questions, please contact the Waukegan Main Street office at 847-623-6650 or email me at arthur@waukeganmainstreet.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Arthur. Jan Gibson, Genesee Theater.
Hi, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have some very good news for Waukegan. I'm pleased to report that during our fourth quarter this last year, Waukegan residents purchased nearly 10% of our show tickets. That's a huge number. The second largest was City of Chicago, next rankings, Gurnee, Libertyville, Lakeville, and Grays Lake. But Waukegan numbers are significant. The citizens of Waukegan should feel proud of their participation in the success of the theater. What we at the theater are proud of also is our 20% growth in attendance from 2015 to 2016. We know that we will increase our numbers again this year as we introduce more and more theater goers to Genesee. We still have good seats for the State Ballet Theater of Russia's Cinderella and also Air Supply for disco fans this weekend. Cheap Tricks seats for March 11th are selling out. We hope to see you at the Genesee. Thanks.
Thank you. Next, committee reports, Finance Committee, Alderman Valco, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Finance Committee, we met this evening and the committee voted to authorize the waiver of a public bid and the sale of the property owned by the City of Waukegan, PIN number 08-29-224-003, located in between 1307 and 1325 Belvedere to the adjacent property owner, Michael Minney, for the appraised value of $1,500. For those of the aldermen that were not here and the general audience as such, what this is a piece of property that's only 20 feet wide between these two businesses, and planning and zoning can't even tell us how long it's been vacant, for years and years. The estimated appraisal value came in at $1,500 from an appraisal firm, and planning and zoning it says that's a valid appraisal. Again, the committee voted to authorize the waiver, and I so move, sir.
Motion by Alderman Valco, second by Alderman Cunningham. Roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Alderman Newsom.
Aye.
Alderman Tempest.
Aye.
Alderman May.
Aye.
Alderman Valco.
Aye.
Alderman Taylor.
Aye.
Alderman Cunningham.
Aye.
Alderman Zeger.
Aye.
Alderman
Aye.
Alderman
Villalobos.
Aye.
Item B was held over, so that's all we have this evening, sir.
Thank you, Alderman Rocco. There is no old business. There are no reports and communication. New business, item A, approval of payroll dated January 6, 2017, in the amount of $1,482,293.84. Motion by Alderman Valco, second by Alderman Cunningham. Roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Alderman Newsom.
Aye.
Alderman Tempest.
Aye.
Alderman May.
Aye.
Alderman Valco.
Aye.
Alderman Taylor.
Aye.
Alderman Cunningham.
Aye.
Alderman Zeger.
Aye.
Alderman Moise.
Aye.
Alderman Villalobos.
Aye.
Item B, approval of bills dated January 16, 2017 in the amount of $1,156,808.06. Motion by Alderman Valco, second by Alderman Cunningham. Roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Mayor.
Yes, ma'am.
I have one question, please. Yes. And I know that we're going to do this at the next Finance Committee meeting, but there is one check that we're writing that's over $20,000. And so I just think it bears, maybe if you can explain it, what's going on at 360 East Seahorse. There's a $32,000 bill being written to AEP Energy. I'm just curious. It's over 20 grand. I don't remember. approving any kind of particular...
I don't really know. Tina, can you explain that, please?
On page 11 of the bill run, there's a check we're writing to AEP Energy for $32,000. $32,500, let's round up, for 360 East Seahorse Drive. So I'm just curious, because the check is so high, it's over 20 grand. And
that's a utility bill for the water plant.
Oh.
For the water plant.
Right, Brian?
Yeah. Is that what it is, Brian?
Right. So utilities is one of the contracts that's exempted under the purchasing. So we do have to pay electric on the utility and the water plant because it's a revenue generating enterprise.
Thank you.
Thank you. A roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Alderman Newsom.
Aye.
Alderman Tempest.
Aye.
Alderman May.
Aye.
Alderman Valco.
Aye.
Alderman Taylor.
Aye.
Alderman Cunningham.
Aye.
Alderman Ziegler.
Aye.
Alderman Moisio.
Aye.
Alderman Villalobos.
Aye.
Item C, approval of raffle sales application for Fat Cat Rescue Incorporated, the Rotary Club of Waukegan, David Miller, and FHCC. Motion by Alderman Moisio, second by Alderman Newsom. All's in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item D, accept and place on file the treasurer's monthly report for December 2016. Motion by Alderman Taylor, second by Alderman Seagar. All's in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Item E, agreement between Three Brothers Theater to occupy 221 North Genesee Street. What's happening is Three Brothers Theater wants to move a second theater to that address. I've talked to the theater. They're willing to have the same agreement we had before as far as utilities and things of that nature go. And we did purchase all the property within the building. So we own the interior of that building.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do we have insurance on that?
Yes.
Okay.
I have a question.
Yes.
I support Three Brothers Theater. I think they're doing great work downtown. I just, it says agreement. You say we're going to do the same thing. So at the next meeting, will we perhaps have a document?
Wasn't there a document attached?
No.
David, do you have the document?
The agreement.
The agreement?
No, I did not. It was presented, I believe, to Steve.
Steve, do you have the agreement? Okay.
Alderman,
I'm sorry. That's an oversight on my part.
It's
exactly the same document as before. All we did is change the name of the leasor.
Unfortunately, we don't have an agreement right now. We wanted to bring it to the council's attention at this point to at least get everyone to support this concept before we went any further. Obviously, it's city-owned space, and justification is we'd rather everyone on the council buy into the concept before we went any further and did any agreements. We did get a letter and an insurance certificate from Three Brothers Theater naming us additionally insured to preempt this. So over the course of the next many days, we will present and prepare an agreement so that everyone can sign off on it and feel comfortable with it, and be sure that we keep all of you informed and abreast as to how we're moving forward on utilizing the space and reactivating that theater again.
Alderman, they won't be moving in until the agreement is signed, period.
I know the people involved, yeah. And I trust the people involved. Yeah. I just think to protect the city, yeah. We have to have a agreement.
That's fine. We will.
Indeed.
I support Three Brothers, and okay. Congratulations.
And this was, sorry.
Go ahead.
And this will be for 1 year, or?
We believe that they have the capacity to present at least 6 shows on that stage, and then we work out our relationship in a really flexible manner and be good neighbors with the folks at the Genesee Theater, and also look at how we can expand the role of that facility and also utilize it better than just a medium amount of shows, and maybe create a more robust calendar on other activities that can take place in that location as well.
So what we're voting on?
No, what I'll tell you what we'll do for this. This will be informational only. I will have that document drafted, and we'll bring it back to City Council and next City Council meeting. That's what we'll do. That way there's no confusion or controversy.
Are they ready to put a show in there before next?
They would be ready. Yes, they would be ready to stage their February show. on the stage there if the timing works out correctly. So certainly time is of the essence, but we will certainly work with the council and Corporation Council and the mayor's office to ensure that we can move forward.
Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to go ahead and allow the theater to get moving under the good faith that at the next council meeting we'll have the agreement.
Yeah, we have.
Let them move ahead.
I do have an agreement, a document signed by them advising me. I'm sorry, Alderman. I thought that was presented to you. Obviously, it was an oversight on my part, but. Steve, can you draft this and get this ready? So that being said, motion by Alderman May, second by Alderman Tempest.
I'll second it, Mayor.
Okay, roll call, please, Madam Clerk.
Alderman Newsom.
Aye.
Alderman Tempest.
Aye.
Alderman May.
Aye.
Alderman Valco.
Aye.
Alderman Taylor.
Aye.
Alderman Cunningham.
Aye.
Alderman Seager.
Aye.
Alderman Moisio.
Aye.
Alderman Villalobos.
Aye.
Great, thank you, everyone.
There are no ordinances and resolutions. Audience time, Madam Clerk.
Jose Zurita.
Jose Zurita, 302 Tennis Street. Well, as you know, the state of Illinois is losing people. The large percentage of people moving out of the state are the young, the entrepreneurial, and the young people, the working bodies. Well, right now, there were good times in the state of Illinois. There were good times in the city of Waukegan. We built, myself and a company I used to have, we built five homes over McAllister alone, plus another homes around the city of Waukegan, Zion, or Chicago. But the times are tough, and everybody's suffering, all of us. Here in the state of Illinois. And we are in a close community here. And my point here is, if we're going to pull out our dirty laundry out for all the rest of the country to see and know what's going on here in Waukegan, I suggest to first go and talk. Probably you heard in kindergarten about Hiawatha and the peacemakers. They start talking. Before that, they used to kill one each other all the way to oblivion. But then the peacemaker came along and they talked with Hiawatha, with the five First Nations, and they get together how to get all together, get along, and pull together to the well-being of the next generations. This is what I'm saying right here. I don't want to hear complaints with the confronting all the peoples around. I will say, give it a chance to the city body, the city administration, to hear their complaints first and by themselves. And it doesn't work it out between two or three people. Talk it over, because we don't want to lose more people here in the city of Waukegan. Good people, good working people. Past administration made bad deeds. Well, I forgive them. I wasn't one of them to complain to them. They never listened. So I took it to court, and things changed a lot. Why? Then we start talking with the next administration, and things are getting better for me. Even I'm losing money right now because no business is coming along. All business, not new business. So this is, I say to all Waukegan residents, talk it over. Don't bet the dirty laundry out. Just talk it over with the official, with the aldermen, with the mayor. They'll listen to you. They will listen.
You,
they have listened to me.
Thank
this
you.
Is my spirit.
Thank you for your time. Mr. Blank.
Yeah. Speaking of, go over there and get that agenda for me, the one on the top. Come on back. Well, speaking of dirty laundry, one of the issues that I'm bringing to you all tonight is I think you all are aware Thank you, sir. Of a situation where at Cook Magnet School, we had a kindergartner that was picked up by the police department. And I would like to think that in the event, I would like to think that in situations like that, that it should never have to be police involvement, or if the police is called to that scene, if a crime has not been committed and there was no crime, never should a kindergartner have to have his first experience being traumatized by being picked up by a police officer, which may cause that kindergartner to have fear of police officers for the rest of their life. It was a situation that took place. The young student, the principal called the police, which we've already dealt with that. And that particular aspect as far as that principal, some changes have been made. And I'm asking the city council that in the future, that when the police is called out, if no crime has been committed, particularly when it comes to a kindergartner, let's see what we can do to lessen the fear of our citizens, particularly our young people, of later on having a fear or a bad experience towards the police as we are trying to rebuild and establish relationship between the community and the police. Never should a kindergartner child have his first experience with the police on a bad note. If we are trying to rebuild relationship between the community and the police, surely we want to start with those future seeds that we are planting in their minds as early as kindergarten. So please take those things into consideration, that we don't want our children having no more of a bad outlook on the police department than we already have out there. On another note, speaking of youth, see this here is Jonathan Garcia, okay? And this is the young man who was allegedly, and you wonder why I keep bringing this up here. This is the young man that was allegedly, that was nose was fractured by in the police department in the booking room. And I bring this up here because you all need to be made aware, because if we're seriously considering changes in our police department and the relationships, then we gotta make sure that police officers, when they do things like this, that they are held accountable, and it's not just swept under the rug. So when I see the mayor parade and bring some of the young Hispanic brothers and sisters up here, and surely they, as young queens and queens, they would do to that. But let's not exploit them in the best interest of trying to get political votes when we are not paying attention to the real issues right here. I got some other things on here, but we'll let that go for now. But thank you for acknowledging our young people when they come here. Ms. Taylor.
Hello, City Council members. My name is Kasia Kondracki, and I am a resident of Waukegan. And as many of you all know, I am a mother as well. As I was standing in line at the field house today to pay my gym membership so that I could go work out while my daughters were in the childcare room, warm and safe, I was scrolling through my newsfeed. As you can see, I literally just wrote this just a few seconds ago. A story jumped out at me, so I had to cancel my plans to come down here and speak to you tonight. Just last night in Portland, Oregon, a baby froze to death. It was a newborn baby born into homelessness just a few hours before. And I instantly recalled the night this time last year when our mayor, Wayne Motley, closed Pads Lake County in Waukegan, knowing well that there was a newborn.
For 2 hours.
Okay, it was still a newborn baby that was one of the clients, and the temperatures were below freezing. And in fact, just so you know, Mayor, that baby that died in Portland, Oregon was only exposed to temperatures for about 6 hours. So just saying. I request that our city council members reflect on the seriousness of this. I ask tonight, how are you all going to prevent another such situation from happening in Waukegan? When parents take their babies to the homeless shelter, this is their absolutely last resort. We must prevent the possibility of such a heartbreaking and pointless death from happening right here in our own town. When we face such harsh winters here ourselves, It takes a village to raise a child, and that includes children who face homelessness. And I just need you all to understand, I'm not going to come up here talking every single time. But as a mother, and as someone who advocates for homelessness because I've had friends end up in the homeless shelter, I at one point escaped an abusive relationship, and one of my options was to go to the homeless shelter for the night possibly to hide, or to go to a safe place and hide. So I'm asking you all please to consider our homeless residents, especially babies. And I'd like to hear from you guys tonight, all of you, your thoughts on how are we going to prevent this? Because that hurt reading that story tonight, and I hope that it hurts your hearts as well, thinking about the fact that that could have happened this time last year. 2 hours versus 6 hours, I'm just saying.
Margaret Carrasco.
Good evening, Margaret Carrasco. I have here in my possession Park City business card, Mayor Motley's right-hand person, with the name of Jorge Torres, aka George Torres, business commissioner for the city of Park City. The secretaries in the office claim that he wasn't in at the moment, but does work every day. Really? Meanwhile, us taxpayers are paying over $100,000 each day to be in charge of licensing and city collections. Number two, the mayor also put George Torres as head of the Port Authority. Mayor, many residents in Waukegan are asking, is this why Waukegan's drugs, crime, shootings, prostitution is out of control? Are the narcos protected here in the city of Waukegan? Residents are asking. Meanwhile, us taxpayers aren't. Residents are asking, Mayor, they're concerned about the deep circles under your eyes, your nosebleeds. They're concerned. Number three, I have a video recording of Mayor Wayne Motley, a federal court deposition, in which he states that it was his idea. And he wrote Waukegan's $500 towing seizure ordinance. Wait till that's blasted on Facebook, that video. And Mayor, I don't know what you did to anger someone this week, because guess what? Came to my doorstep a pile of love letters, faxes, photos, emails sent to many, many different females. Some are signed by Love Wayne, some are signed Wayne Motley, some are on the letterhead from Waukegan Police Department. And I want you to look on the second page of, sorry, my printer messed up. And this letter tops them all. Because in this letter, in a nutshell, Wayne is calling pretty much essentially Waukegan residents stupid, insults women. Thank you. Please look forward. Every single one of these will be posted on internet, so every resident can read what he thinks about Waukegan voters. Thank you.
Ralph Peterson.
Hello, everyone. I would like to thank all you who attended the various functions over the last few days in honoring Dr. Martin Luther King. They were pretty cool. We had a nice time. Now, for the last month or so, citizens that I bump into continuously ask me about the Brumsfield House, you know, because they feel kind of sorry for the guy, you know, and anybody with a heart would. And I had to tell him I didn't know. You know, I mean, I basically had just been hearing what Brother Blank say, and I can't say what the aldermen say because nobody says anything. So I call myself a lightweight investigator. So I looked into the matter, and man, I couldn't believe it. It actually kept me up at night because I got a little salty at all you aldermen because you're kind of letting myself and the citizens be misled. First of all, I didn't know that incident was in 205. And then I done more research and I found out you were not even in motion up here at that time. Edith, no one else. So I said, well, who was here? Because these guys need to be speaking up when Brother Blanks bring this issue up here. Myself and the citizens were under the impression, I thought Mayor Motley had something to do with this. And I was gonna even, you know, say, hey, Mayor, what's going on? Well, come to find out, the only people that were sitting on this bench up here at that time was Mozio, Cunningham, Tempest, and it was up under Mayor High. So that left my mouth hanging open. And I'm saying, why, what is going on? You guys are letting myself and the public think that this is something that just happened, you know, I'm thinking within the last 2-3 years. So I went further. And I told you, I stated that I will not allow you citizens to be hoodwinked. You know, we're gonna know the facts. So I dug back into the news, son, back in 205, and I see where the city offered to buy Brumsfield home, but Brumsfield demanded $150,000, which is significantly more than market value. Alderman Sam Cunningham, who wards includes Brumsfield home, said that the home needs a new roof, trusses, and it's dangerous and it's collapsing, and it has come to the point where his house is falling down. Cunningham said it's such a bad condition that we can't afford to have that house sitting. We've given him plenty of opportunities. So then I dug back a little more, and Cunningham, I'm not coming at you because I'm going to come at Mozio and Tempest too. But you guys should be addressing this.
Thank you.
Mr.
Peterson, your
time
is up. Thank you.
Alderman's time, Maria.
Alderman Newsom?
Pass.
Alderman Tempest? Alderman Tempest?
Yeah, I'm thinking whether I should respond to the gentleman or not. I did teach with Arthur Brumfield.
You might.
I did teach with Arthur Brumfield, and I thought the school district, one teacher, in fact, went out of his way to try to help Arthur get established. But Arthur seems to go his own way. And his house down there, it is an eyesore. It was an eyesore. And the solution to it, I really don't know. But it's all cleared out but his. If you want any economic development to ever get started down there, his is basically the only house left down there. And we ought to be working somehow. But Arthur don't want to move. And what do? Kick somebody out of their house? Then what are you? He's a house on an island there. And Arthur does have some issues, I'll put it that way. But I remember when he was a teacher at the school working with kids. But his demeanor, I think, really hurt Arthur in the long run. And I wish him well, but I think he needs some help.
Alderman. Your Honor, next Alderman.
Are you done, Alderman Tempest?
I'm done.
Yep, Alderman May.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Mr. Peterson, I think several times when Brother Blanks comes up and addresses the issue with Mr. Brumfield, he often refers to the fact that the house was actually torn down more than 10 years ago. He repeats that fact almost every time he's up here. And points out the fact that not all of us were there. So I don't think any of us are trying to pull the wool over the citizens' eyes and pretend that it's anyone's fault, because Brother Blanks, when he speaks, he always refers back to that it happening long before many of us were up here. So that's why I've never addressed that fact. It does trouble me that the city did that 10 years ago, and now for 10 years, Mr. Brumfield's been on his property, and his property maybe, you know, if you drive by or live next to it, is not in the best state affairs, but the city has let it go on and on and on. And so here we are 10 years later without a solution. So I don't know what the solution is either. I've reached out before to Mr. Brumfield, Brother Blanks, and out to another friend of Mr. Brumfield's, Mr. Holly, to see if there's any way that we all can come together and figure out a solution, because obviously we all have a big heart for Mr. Brumfield. So that'll be my comment on that situation. Kasha, the homelessness and the pads issue in town also troubles me very much, so I can't, there you are. I have also met with Joel Williams recently, and I've also met with the folks over at YCC. And I actually went to a wonderful celebration for the Lake County United this past weekend. They celebrated the opening of 40 affordable housing units and their supportive housing units for people, not only just homeless people, but people with disabilities and such. Beautiful, brand new construction in downtown Mundelein, accessible to stores, walkable to a grocery store, you know, your basic amenities. And so it's proof positive that there is a way to solve some of these issues. And I know that Mayor Motley is very supportive of Housing First. I think we can't just wipe pads out. We need to work together. We need pads. They help our homeless population. And at the same time, we also need to work towards affordable and supportive housing for these people. It's going to solve a lot of our issues. Tonight, during the Finance Committee meeting, we did have a report on the general fund, and we have received projections that the general fund will end the year with the deficit of approximately $606,000, which does go back, and I'm sorry, I'm going to say it, to the Grand Ave Bridge mistakes. There was mistakes made in the capital improvement project for the Grand Ave Bridge. A few weeks ago, we were told that there was a surplus. The surplus was from fiscal year 15-16, because we just got our audit. This year, the troubles with the bridge, the troubles with the MFT fund, they're real. They're here. We got the report. Revenues over the from fiscal year 15 to fiscal year 17, this is fiscal year 17, this year that we're in right now that ends April 30th, revenues grew 2.5% over this time period. But our expenses increased 17.9% in the city. There's a problem there. We have the firefighters down in personnel, taking the hit, keeping themselves within budget, while we have a public works department that's 27% over budget. So our budget this year counted for a surplus of we were supposed to end the year with a surplus of almost $500,000 this year, $455,000. We're gonna end up projected approximately $600,000 over. This is a real issue, and it's going to be a real issue for budgeting next year. We can't play a shell game. We have a true financial issue, and we're all going to work together up here to work on that budget next year. But don't be mistaken. There's going to have to be cuts somewhere, because there's just not enough money. You know, what do you do in your household? You got to make cuts when there's not enough money to support the budget. So I applaud, you know, the building department and the firefighters for carrying their end of the game here. But unfortunately, we do have some serious financial issues in front of us. We also talked about some CDBG amendments tonight at Finance Committee, and it was held over. So I look forward to further discussion on that.
but it seems curious to me that we're making all these adjustments, and Alderman Cunningham was pointing out, a lot of it had to do with the first ward. And I just question, and I don't know the answer to this question, so I look forward, but I want someone to show me that this isn't positioning for the South Sheridan project. I don't know if it is or it isn't. The mayor did say during the Finance Committee meeting that he was intending to present us with information to use CDBG funds for this development on the south side, but none of that information has been disseminated to this body that I'm aware of. So I look forward to that discussion and encourage the public to stay tuned. And my only other statement is I did very much enjoy the Martin Luther King festivities down at First Corinthian Church, and as well at the Dreamers Breakfast yesterday. Hundreds, maybe thousands of people came out to celebrate the life of Martin Luther King Jr.'s, and it was a very, very moving and wonderful program. But what really struck my heart during this Martin Luther King holiday was I had the opportunity to go to the Youth Conservation Corps and Youth Build that helps the youth in our community who maybe have dropped out of a high school, need their GED, need job and training to make their way in this world. And they use Martin Luther King Day for a day of service. And they join in the National Day of Service. So it was wonderful to see, you know, 20, 30 young adults struggling to make it in this world, give their day to serve others in our community. So I want to give a big shout out to the folks over at YCC. And that's all I have. Thank you.
We don't have questions. It's Alderman's time.
Alderman Valco?
Pass.
Alderman Taylor?
First, I'd like to straighten out. I had a Waukegan resident call me telling me that American Outfitters was going out of business in Waukegan, and I was like, okay. Hadn't heard that, and I was a little stunned by it. After doing some research, I think what they heard was that American Eagle Outfitters is going out of business nationwide with 150 stores closing. So I just want to clarify that. Second, I'd like to thank the Waukegan Police Department for, we had a lot of armed robberies in the city between November 17th and January 12th. And thanks to our Waukegan Police Department, Gurnee Police Department, and the Lake County Sheriff's Office, we have solved that and now have two suspects in custody. Third, I'd like to thank the Waukegan Township for putting on a fantastic Dreamers Breakfast yesterday. And last, I guess I want to address Mrs. Carrasco's concerns here in that I think the mayor has been very proactive in addressing issues with the Department of Justice and that kind of thing. And I guess what my concern is here is maybe we need to be a little proactive here and look at some of these situations. I don't want to continually see our employees be put through camera time at City Council. On the other hand, I want to make sure that we are addressing residents' concerns. And if you feel like there's ethics violations, then maybe we need to sit down and appoint an ethics committee that looks at some of this stuff, just to help our residents feel like we are addressing some of these issues. I think that would be fair to everybody, just like we've done it in other areas. I think it's time to maybe take a proactive reaction to this and maybe put an end to some of the discussion behind what's happening here. And let's have a discussion about it. Thank you.
Alderman Cunningham.
One of them, to the Arthur Brumfield situation, Mr. Blanks has been more vocal than anybody in this room, and personally to me, when it comes to Arthur Brumfield's situation. I do know this, and I can say this with certainty, that as we move forward with South Sheridan Revitalization Plan, that Mr. Brumfield's will be represented well as he moves forward. One of the things I disagree with when we came to the rezoning in the past, rezoning has always been at the petitioner's request. Mr. Brumfield did not ask, did not want his property to be rezoned, and that is his right. When his name was on that rezoning petition, I think myself and several other aldermen voted no because of that reason. But what I do know is this, as Mr. Brumfield and this particular project moves forward, he can rest assured not only the first ward alderman, I think all aldermen are going to be looking out for the best interest not only of him, but the taxpaying citizens of this community. Second, I had an opportunity to speak with some business owners. And I do believe, I think it is time that we take a look at it may appear to be a small issue, but it has become a large issue to our small business community. And that issue is the fine that is assessed on a small business person when, for example, the licensing. There is a license fee, say, of $100, $150. If that person fails because of forgot, maybe didn't have the money, it automatically goes to a 50% fine. And that is per business license. More specifically to rental license. Each and every rental unit that you have must receive a rental license. So there's $135, George? $135, that's the fee, the annual fee?
Per unit.
Yeah, so per unit. If it's not paid, then it goes to 135 plus 50% of the 135. I then ask, what is the percentage if the water bill is late? From my understanding, it is at only 10%. Now, I don't know about most of you, but the most precious commodity that we have in the city of Waukegan is our water. Now, and I'm not suggesting that we go 50% on the water bill fee if it's not paid in time, on time, but to impose a 50% increase on that, those fees are not paid at 30 days. There's not a 10%, there's not like a gradual, and I think we've talked about this before, but on the machines, on the slot machines, what are those, George? What are the fees, annual fees for those?
$1,000.
If you're late on those, George, it goes to $500 per machine, correct?
That is correct.
The question becomes, is that right? I think particularly, and we're talking about business, the small business guy. We're not talking about major corporations. I don't know about most of you, but a small business guy, a $500 hit could be 2 weeks of profit. Certainly, we could never, ever backfill a deficit budget in the city of Waukegan off the backs of the small business people. And I don't think that's our intent.
understanding these, when this was passed, from my understanding, it was passed when our fees used to be much, much smaller. $10, $5, so it didn't make a difference. But to impose a 50% increase on those small businesses, I think that is something we should look at and come up with a gradual way of assessing fines, particularly if the most precious commodity from a revenue generator is our water. If we're only doing 10% there, why are we doing 50% on the small items? And I take blame to it. I hold blame to it. But now that we know, when you know better, you do better. We know now. I am asking that we put this in our finance committee for some real hard discussion. Mr. Torres, who's now our city collector, because his customer service, and I'm saying customer service, what are the tech, are they customer service reps, or are they, your staff, his staff, they should be customer service reps, that's what they really should be, because that's what they act like. They have to be the one to explain this 50% increase. I'll give you an example that we used to use at when I was at Allstate in customer service. The first time, there is a 5%. The second time, 10%. If we found that this person is abusing that privilege, then we move on. But we have a hardcore line, and then we don't give the staff a means to negotiate. And if they don't, we hold them hostage by not issuing the license. That's in the ordinance, correct, George? That's in the ordinance. So there needs to be a little buffer. The goal is not to stop those small businesses, but it's try to help the small business. That is the backbone of this community. So I'm asking, and I'm assuming this is going to be on our agenda at the next finance, so we can probably have some conversations around how we can probably revise this so it's more equitable to those small business owners. Last but not least, I do have some good news, and I'm patting myself on the back as a papa. And I'm gonna read this as it is in the University of Illinois Springfield. Sierra Cunningham is now the all-time leader in rebounding for the University of Illinois women's basketball program after collecting 16 boards in a 59-53 victory versus McKendree. The senior, I'm saying Waukegan, but it's not Waukegan in here, it says Beach Park, Illinois, needed just 5 to break the mark coming into the game, but put together her third best rebounding performance of the season to win for the Prairie Stars for the victory. And I'm saying it as a proud father for Sierra. And Mr. Morzio, Mr. Tempest, Mr. Valco, and I think all, and I say this because I know how intimately they're involved with their children. But this young lady put in the time at the gym. When other girls were doing other things, she was at the gym. I'm singling my daughter out because we talked about young men and young ladies today, giving them an opportunity. I heard our president talk about his daughter and where the schools that they're going. They have the means for his daughter to go to the various schools there. I had the means to be at the field house, to be at Carmen School. And if I'm not mistaken, I saw Mr. May in here, who was Sierra's first coach at Abbott Middle School. This is what I want other parents to experience with their children in Waukegan. Mr. Blanks, bringing these young men up here, allowing them to see what time, commitment, effort, the backing of the parents, their school, and our city. I'm happy for her, but I'm more importantly, I'm proud for her that she achieved that. What about the other young men at YCC, at Youth Build, Boys and Girls Club? This is what I think we are all about, making sure these young men and these young ladies have a good opportunity to be successful in life. And to hear that a kindergarten experienced an officer, and I can tell you right now, our officers who went out there were very uncomfortable. I know they were. To watch this little boy and happen to have him interact with police on a negative situation. And I think the school board has already addressed that, but for my daughter and for other parents who are here, I hope you experience the same thing that Sam and Rayanne has experienced with their daughter, with success early on in their lives, so then it carries on, so they can be successful citizens in our society and come back, hopefully to Waukegan, but to prospective cities, and live their lives. Thank you.
Alderman Seeger? Okay. Alderman Moisio?
Yeah. Because for all our outward differences, we all share the same proud title, citizen. President Obama said that in his farewell speech. Sort of got me thinking. And as a 26-year teacher in Waukegan Public Schools, I've sort of seen that erode. Obviously, you learn how to be a citizen. You learn your rights and responsibilities and your duties. I learned most of mine, obviously, from my parents, but it was always reinforced in District 60. I learned how to be respectful, how to have compassion, how to have pride, tolerance, what was good for everybody. And I also learned, obviously, at the end of the day, it's all about self-responsibility. If I screwed up, I screwed up. That was enforced at home. It was enforced in District 60. I also learned how to talk to adults, how not to talk to adults, how to question authority in the right way. That's why I'll always support audience time. My mother has on the refrigerator this day, she's got a sign that says, question authority. But duty of a citizen is you always have to question authority. That doesn't mean be disrespectful to the authority, but you have the right to question it. And authority should always have an answer for you at some time. We have lost our way in American schooling, not only in District 60. You read all the time about the news, about some small issue, and all hell breaks loose. And there's all this talk about Common Core, Common Core. I think the Common Core in schools needs to shift back to learn how to be a citizen. I learned a lot of knowledge in school, but I learned far more in District 60. I'm sure Sam did, I'm sure Lisa did, because we went the same time. We learned how to be a good person, how to be a citizen, how to get along, and all those things that make society better. And it's just been a slow erosion, and I've seen it. And it's not just germane to District 60. If you read the news, it's all over the place. That's why we have all these issues all over, or something just turns from a mountain from a molehill. It doesn't need to be that way. I think the schools have got to start to focus less on Common Core and testing. My God, we overtest these kids like it's going out of style. Jesus. That's right, tell me. That's right. My God, they can do one thing. They can fill a bubble sheet out, I'll tell you that. But we forgot to teach them how to learn. How to learn, not only in knowledge, but how to learn in society, how to get along, how to handle situations.
how not to accept responsibility. You can cuss a teacher out, cuss an adult out. Oh, that's okay. That's okay. That's not how to get along in a society, and we all know that. That's not how to do it. We've lost our way in that, and I think they need to stop thinking about Common Core as far as knowledge, but think of Common Core as how to get along in the society to make everything better. Because like Obama said, at the end of the day, we should all be proud citizens. Now, to Mr. Brumfield's situation. It might have not have been handled, was it 10 years ago, in the right way. But we were told his house had to come down. It was unsafe. The last thing I wanted was for his house to come down and Arthur to be in it. But going, that's water under the bridge. But going forward, Mr. Brumfield, more people than you know want to work with you on this issue. They want to work with you on this issue. I don't know who to go to or who you would trust on this, but if you can find somebody up here on the city council that you trust, I'm assuming you trust Brother Blanks, and that's good. If you can find somebody up here that you trust or somebody in the city that you trust, and you will listen to them, I know that they will work with you to try to get to a solution that's good for you and good for the city. Because this is a two-sided situation. It's two-sided, Mr. Okay, well, I know it is. I'm not going to get an argument with you. And I've said up here before, the greatest thing about America is property rights. And sometimes the worst thing about America is property rights. But that's okay. You find somebody you trust in the city and with Brother Blanks, and we'll see if we can't get this worked out for the betterment of you and the city. Now, to the homeless issue. It's a situation that I know everybody here on the council is open to any idea anybody has. You rack your brain on trying to figure out how to deal with it. It's a very tricky situation on how to deal with it. We have to try to help these people, but we also, again, we have to try to do what's right for all of the city. And if anybody's got any solutions on that, you can come forward to me. If anybody, this is not a discussion, so we're not gonna get in. If you wanna see me after the meeting, you can. If anybody knows my parents, that's been their passion. Alderman Tempest will vouch for that. My dad used to run a couple of pad sites. My mother and father gave away a house on North Avenue for affordable housing. So my family's compassion for affordable housing and for the homeless runs deep. Understand that. Thank you.
Alder Villalobos. Okay, thank you everyone for being out here tonight. I'll try to keep this brief. So I've taken stock and I've reviewed my year of 2016 as it came to an end. And again, to me, time is the most important thing that we have in this world. And I've been reflecting on how I spent my time. And to be honest with you, me personally, I feel like I haven't done enough in 2016. So I'm trying to recommit myself to Waukegan for 2017. And as such, one of the things I wanted to recommit myself to is, again, the youth, super important to me. Part of it is just being there. So I've taken it upon myself, you know, to go to more events, more sporting events for the youth, and lead into other activities with them. For example, like today, in partnership with Abbott Middle School that I'm hoping to build further on, the Young Men of Vision and the Ladies of Distinction got together with myself and the teacher, and we did partnership of the principal, Tim Briner, we did a trash pickup. Again, things that are near to me and dear to me, trash, right? Try to get that picked up. It was wonderful to see about 30 students pick up trash right on their lots, right on their school property, and they enjoyed it. Talked to a couple of students afterwards. They say, we need to do this every 2 weeks. Again, this is to me like the modeling situation. As an alderman, I'm not too big in society to bend over and pick up trash. So to me, these are one of the projects and things I want to work forward with to, again, reinvest myself in Waukegan. I want to do more in 2017,
and I want to be partnering with more organizations and learning more and being more engaged. And part of that trash pickup with the Abbott Middle School is part of a bigger picture with the Washington Street corridor. So there was a merchants neighbors group started on Washington Street corridor. I'm working more with them to get that group going so they can have a voice about what's going on in that corridor and that street. And then with that group in mind, it comes down to downtown Waukegan, also in Fourth Ward, and I had a meeting with the merchants there. So again, as I worked further to get the Fourth Ward more cohesive and dialoguing, groups like this and projects like this start overlapping with each other. So I look forward for this upcoming year to do more of that. The business meetings with the merchants, it's a great project that I'm helping with. Again, I just want to help, again, reinvest myself in 2017, basically my point. I want to do more, I want to be more engaged, more involved. Clean Power Lake County, I want to do more with that. So if anybody's interested in learning about Clean Power Lake County, you can reach me at 217-766-9390 to do a one-on-one, and I'll tell you about the campaign and see if we can work on that. Also, homelessness was brought up today. I actually sit, and I say sit, I haven't really been engaged. I am on the advisory committee for the Stabenhaus House. For me, that's a microcosm of the macrocosm of homelessness in Waukegan. I have a meeting to see where I can actually do more with the Stabenhaus House. I don't want to just sit on a committee. I want to be actively engaged in it. So again, recommitting myself to the use of my time. And for this year, I want to get more involved with that as well. So to me, this is a good start of the month, start of the year for me, 2017. I felt like I went through my sophomore slump as an alderman. I'm ready to do more. I want to do more. I've recommitted myself to do more. So I'll keep it at that. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming here tonight. I really appreciate it.
I'd like to make a point of clarification to Ms. Carrasco. Ms. Carrasco, your disdain and disgust for me is obvious. What I find offensive is that you chose to publish this letter knowing that it's 17 years old. I find that disgusting, and you should be ashamed of yourself. Thank you. Good night.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion and second. All's in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
The city of Waukegan is replacing about 20,000 water meters with a new automated meter, which provide for an accurate, timely, and reliable reading without having to gain access to customers' properties. The new meters, which will be replaced at no cost to the customers, will be able to identify high water usage and potential leaks. In addition, customers will be able to access their water usage and account information conveniently online. The first thing you need to do is schedule an appointment with Professional Meters, Inc. to have your old meter replaced with a new automated meter reader, AMR for short. Look for a postcard in the mail with the call information or call 866-270-9629. PMI will arrive at your scheduled time to install your meter. They will arrive on a truck or a van with a PMI logo. The PMI installer will have on a shirt or a jacket with a PMI logo and will carry a PMI ID badge. Installers will also wear booties over their work boots to ensure they do not carry dirt, mud, or water into your home or business. The installation process should take less than 30 minutes. The installer will take a photo of the old meter to obtain a record of your final meter reading and the condition of the pipes and fittings. The next step is to turn off your shutoff valves located on your water meter line near the meter. Remove the old meter and install the new AMR meter. The transmitter, which transmits your water usage data to the city, will be placed on a convenient location near the meter. The installer will take a photo of the new meter once it's installed. And that's it. The PMI installer will make sure everything is cleaned up, collect his tools, and head on to the next installation. You may receive a follow-up visit from a PMI manager to ensure your satisfaction with the installation and to make a quality control check of the meter installation. For more information about the automated meter reading installation program, please visit www.waukeganil.gov. If you have any questions regarding the meter installation, contact PMI at 866-270-9629 or the City of Waukegan City Collector at 847-599-2997.